Good to see everyone. It's always good to gather together on the Lord's Day with the people of God. We've done that. And we're certainly happy that we're assembled here. May God bless you for being here this evening. You've come to a good place where the Word of God is studied, where it's respected, where I believe that it's taught and it's upheld and it's simply obeyed in our lives. As we discussed this morning, we want to obey God's Word. In doing so, we obey God. That is our purpose in life as we're here to serve Him. We're going to study about something that I believe that I think a lot of people are quite confused about. Is a topic that is in the Word of God, and of course it is answered in the Word of God. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Every question that we have has been given to us, the answer has been given to us in God's Word. And throughout our lives as Christians, as we serve God, there are a lot of issues that come up, a lot of things worthy of debate, worthy of discussion, and worthy of finding out what God's Word has to say about the answer. But I hope by looking at God's Word, God's revelation, that what we're going to be talking about will help us maybe clear up some of the confusion that we're hearing a lot of out there in the world today. We'll begin by a series of questions. How much do you know about the people of Israel? How much do you know about the people? How much do you know about modern day Israel? The reports I'm getting, most folks there are atheists. That's just the most of the recent reports that I've heard of modern day Israel. The ones that I know that visit there, a lot of atheism now in Israel. What is their current relationship with God? What is Israel's current relationship with God? What do you think about that? Number three is the nation of Israel in the Middle East, the modern Israel that we know it, is that nation the chosen people of God? And I have number four here, does God have a special plan for the Jews, for Israel in the future? You know, if you watch television very much and the ministry of various preachers, you know that most of them hold the nation of Israel on a very high pedestal and they speak very highly of Israel in that regard. Chief among those, I believe, though, is a man named John Hagee. And I've gave you on the handout, I wrote down his name there. What he is the pastor of the church, the Cornerstone Church in San Antonio, Texas. And he's also head of the organization in this country called Christians That Are United for Israel. He is the president of that organization. I don't believe that there's another preacher in America who has advocated more than John Hagee for the nation of Israel, and that's why I make mention of him. That's why I've put his website on your handout. That's why I wrote those questions down that he insists upon, and Hagee's teaching is this. Let's look at it. It's on your outline. Point one, that in his teaching, he insists that God owes Israel. God owes Israel. Point two, Israel is God's chosen people today. All right, he makes that point. That they are the people of God today. He makes that point. And that all nations must befriend Israel. Point three that he makes there. And looking at the statement that's on your handout, and of course on the website, this is a quote, "The day America turns its back on Israel is the day God will turn his back on America." Nations must befriend Israel is really the theme of a lot of folks out there. And if Israel's not befriended and supported by the United States of America, it will bring judgment on this country. And that's basically what is being taught by him as well as others. He says that God will bless you if you're a friend to Israel. And if you're not a friend to Israel, God will curse you. All right, so that's some pretty strong language and pretty really strong teaching that's going on out there. I think it's serious business. Indeed, it is serious business. So we need to ask the question, is Hagee right? Is that kind of teaching right? It's obviously being taught far and wide out in the world. Does God indeed today have a special place, a special covenant with Israel? And some would say, you know, I'm looking at this and writing it out, and I'm thinking, well, you know what? Who cares? You know what I mean? They come to me. There might be some of you sitting out there, why are we talking about this? And who really cares? I don't care. Do you care? Who cares if God has something going on with Israel? It doesn't mean anything to this church, so why are we talking about it? Well, my response to that would be because there is error in the religious world. Part of what we do here is teach the truth in a positive way. We uphold the truth of God, but also those things that are negative, we need to be able to stop the mouths of false teachers. And you do too. when that time comes, you need to be able to say, wait a minute, that's not in the Bible, that's error. So that's why we're addressing that, or why we're maybe looking at it tonight. And if Hagee's right, if he's right, if those things and those statements in your handout are right, then we're in trouble. We need to support modern day Israel. If he's right, we haven't been in any way, shape, or form, even recognizing them as everybody else does. So if this guy's right and those statements are right, and everybody that's teaching that's right, folks, we need change. We need to change and do what's right. So if you're wrong and don't support modern Israel, the curse of God's going to be upon us as a congregation, as well as on us as individuals. And I think there's more. Does God indeed have a special covenant with the modern nation of Israel? As the Jews, or are the Jews, the chosen people of God today? Hagee would affirm that. As well as 99% of your Baptist friends would affirm that. As well as 99.9% of your friends that go to any denomination out there would affirm that. And say, yes, definitely Israel has a special place in God's heart right now today. And he's going to be doing some things with modern day Israel later in the future. And that's why we need to make sure we're friends with Israel. Yes, sir. They have that place. Even in one of the conventions, I heard one of the speakers say that we need to be a friend to Israel to fulfill prophecy. That prophecy's coming. This is the reason that we need to make sure we're friends as a nation with Israel, because that's in the Bible. We need to make sure we are. So, am I in danger if I don't support modern Israel? Are we in danger? What's God think about that? A little historical background. Genesis chapter 12. We need some historical background about the nation of Israel. Most people don't know a thing about the nation of Israel, especially today. First thing I want us to see and say is, as we go back to the Old Testament, here we're going to look at a sheep herder. His name is Abraham. And 2,000 years before Jesus came, Abraham walked on the earth. And here it is, the fact that God chose a man, Abraham. And what he did, God chose Abraham and gave Abraham three specific promises. Three. He said, that, and really they're important promises, and that we need to know what they are. All right, Genesis 12, let's see the three promises made. Beginning verse 1. Now, the Lord said to Abraham, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land that I will show you. There it is. There's the land promise. First verse. The land promise to Abraham. And I will make you a great nation. There's the second promise. Land promise. A nation promise. All right. I'll bless you. I'll make your name great. And so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you and those who curse you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. There's promise number three. That's often quoted as the seed promise, all right? Land promise, nation promise, seed promise. Genesis chapter 22, verse 18, God himself uses that exact language when he says this, in your seed, talking to Abraham, in your seed, verse 18, Abraham, all the nations will be blessed. So there you have the three promises given in the 12th chapter of the first book of the Bible to Abraham, a land promise, a nation promise, a seed promise, all right? What are those promises? Well, those three promises really constitute the very foundational elements of every book in the Bible, all right? This book, those three promises. Now, what happens in that? That's what the Bible's all about. From Genesis chapter 12 and onward through, it's about fulfilling those three promises. That's what it's about. That's the outline. Here's the three promises, and now the entire scripture, till we get to the end of it, is about these three promises in one form or the other, and that were made to man, all right, a great nation. Here's promise number one. God said, I'm going to make you a great nation, all right? That was fulfilled in Israel, all right? Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 1. God spoke to the people of Israel. All right, now, in verse 7, he says to the people of Israel, what great nation is there that is so near to God as you are? Can't be any nation compared as compared to Israel, because they were God's people. He severed them from every nation that they would be his. What great nation? God himself calls Israel a nation. All right, Well, did God fulfill the nation promise? I'm going to make you a great nation. Yeah, right here it is. God fulfilled his promise to make Israel a great nation. Promise one is filled. All right. Well, what about the land thing? God said, I'm going to give you land. I'm going to give you a great land. All right. Now, that promise was fulfilled in when he gave him the land of Canaan. Look in your Bible to Joshua. Joshua chapter 21, verse 43. Here Joshua is the man who is, after the death of Moses, he's leading Israel, the nation Israel, into the promised land. Listen to what he says in verse 43. 21, 43. So the Lord gave Israel just part of the land. A little bit of the land. Land south of the land. What's the word? All the land. So the Lord gave Israel all the land. There's the land promise made to Abraham has been fulfilled. Now, the land promise is there. Well, how much of the land? All the land. Any more land given to Israel? No. No, the promise that was made by God, that's it. Not some of it. All the land. All right. Now, when Haggai and others like him say that God owes Israel, what does he owe them? What does God owe the nation of Israel that he's not... What does he owe them? God still owe Israel some land? No. Does God owe Israel as being a nation? No. No, that was done too. So those two promises, look at verse 43, that he'd sworn to give all his fathers, and they took possession of it, they dwelt in it. The land, all of it. Look at verse 44. And the Lord gave the rest on every side according to all that he had sworn to the fathers. There's all those promises. And no one of their enemies stood before them. The Lord gave all their enemies into their hand. Not one of the good promises which the Lord had made to the house of Israel failed. Just part of them came to pass. Just a little bit of them. Half of them. All the promises came to pass. Can you read it? All the promises given to Israel came to pass. What about promise number three? About the seed promise, wherein all the families and all the nations are going to be blessed. Well, Galatians 3:16, and he's simply talking to Abraham and talking about the promise that he made to Abraham. And he says in verse 16, to your seed, who is Jesus Christ, Christ the Messiah. Jesus Christ is the one who has come to do what? Bless all nations, everyone, Jew and Gentile alike. All right. And so God made these three promises to Abraham, and every promise that God made to Abraham and to the people of Abraham, to the nation of Israel, God has fulfilled. God has not failed in any of his promises. He has fulfilled all of his promises to the people of Abraham. God didn't fail in any of his promises. And for us to say, or anyone to say, that God still owes Israel, as Haggai and others say, that it really misunderstands either the nature of the promises. All right. Now, that's a good possibility. There's a lot of folks that don't understand the nature of the promises. All right. Or how God has fulfilled those promises. Well, maybe he's fulfilled all those promises to Israel. But I'm going to tell you what. I think Israel's still God's special people. And God still has a special place with the Jewish nation. After all, they're still his chosen people. The people of Israel today are still special to God. I hear that all the time. Where'd you get that? Did you hear somebody say that? Did you hear somebody on TV say that? You just repeating what somebody said about Israel? About how God feels about Israel? Did you get that in the newspaper or a periodical? Or have you just heard that so long that you believe it and you just keep repeating it? Because I can't find it in the Bible. It's not in the Scripture. But we hear that all the time. They're still the ones. We're just repeating sometimes, I think, Jesus is the standard of authority. Everything that we preach, teach, and believe comes from the authority of Christ. And if I can't put my finger on it where the Lord said it, I can't teach it, and I can't believe it. But folks are doing that. Well, Jesus is going to tell us where the nation of Israel stands with God. So let's talk about Jesus Christ and the nation of Israel. Was the Lord a Jew? Certainly he was. He was a Jew. And let me say to you that for more than 3 years in the Lord's ministry, 3 years, Jesus was in conflict, not agreement. He was in conflict with Israel. He was in conflict with the Jewish nation. Jesus himself, a Jew, and I need to remind you that Jesus was rejected by his own people, by the Jews, who he was sent to, rejected by the Jewish people. John 1, what was read to us, as you look at that, what'd they do? His own. Who's his own? The Jewish people. His own people that he was sent to in Israel rejected him. Now, much of Jesus' teaching was directed to how the Jews were rejecting him. He addressed that. And here's the one. Here's the Messiah. Here's the King. And yet you reject him. And you can read, I don't know, Matthew, if you're not doing anything tonight, look Matthew 21, about 7 chapters. And all of that talks about that. But starting in Matthew 21, again about 7 consecutive chapters, Jesus and the Jewish leaders, the Jewish nation, Jesus and the Jews were in conflict with each other. You know what they finally do? They kill him. They kill him in Matthew 27. All right? Now, Matthew 21, let's go there. Look at verse 31. Now, in this verse, we're talking about doing the will of God. Which one of you, Matthew 21, 31, which of the two did the will of the Father? They said to him, the first. Jesus said to them, and this Jesus now speaking, who's he talking to? It's the Jewish leaders, all right? The heads of the Jewish nation, really. Assuredly, I say to you that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you do. Who's going to be right with God? Who's going to be right with God in the kingdom of God? It's going to be the tax collectors. It's going to be the harlots. It's going to be the people that accept and not reject Jesus Christ. And what he's making the parallel is that they're going to enter the kingdom of God, not you. Not those that are rejecting, all right? Matthew 23, notice that. Let's go there. The people reject him. Well, God has a special relationship with those people, though, doesn't he? Let's read that. Matthew 23, verse, where do I want? 37. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets, stones those who are sent here. He says, how often I would have gathered your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling. Behold, your house is being left to you desolate. Your house, your nation, your country, your kingdom. For I say unto you, from now on, he says, you will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Well, this is not a blessing to Jerusalem. This isn't the Messiah's here, Jesus here. This isn't some kind of blessing that they're going to have. Jesus here is speaking of the destruction of Jerusalem, of Israel, of the nation, of the kingdom. That the Jews, they rejected the Lord. That's his point. Why? They're unwilling to follow him. Well, look a couple verses later. Look at chapter 24, verse 1. Jesus came out of the temple and was going away when his disciples came up, pointed to the temple buildings to him, and he said, do you see all these things? Oh, we're going to bless you. We're going to do all that. No. No. Do you see all these things? You think Jesus is going to promise a future blessing for the nation of Israel here? Here's the Messiah. Here's the Savior. Here's the Jewish nation. Here's the people. You see all these things? Get ready. I'm going to just bless you. I'm going to have a special place in my heart for you. No. No, what's he say? He says, do you see him? Truly I say to you, not one stone will be left upon top of another, which is going to be destroyed. It's going to be torn down. Wow. Here Jesus says the temple in the city of Jerusalem is going to be destroyed. When was that? 70 AD. Totally, they plowed the place under. You didn't know the place was there. Utter destruction. Desolate is what happened to Jerusalem and the temple. What a prophecy. But the real bomb is found in Matthew 21. All right, let's go there. Matthew 21. See how the text here, Jesus withdraws God's approval from the Jewish nation. Notice what he does in verse 44. He says this, 42. Jesus said to them, did you never read the scripture? The stone which the builders rejected. Who's the builders? Jewish nation, the Jews. They rejected, he says, this became the chief cornerstone. This came about from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes. He asked that. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing the fruit of it. And he who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, but on whomever it falls, it will scatter him like dust. And some translations say grind you up like powder. Well, does that sound like future blessing for the people of Israel? In just those three verses, Jesus is the stone the builders have rejected. He's the chief cornerstone of what God's building. And he's been rejected by the Jewish nation. Remember what he said in John 1? Remember that? A few moments ago, the scripture reading, Jesus came to his own. What? His own did not receive him. They rejected him. The kingdom of God is pictured here as what? A building. It's pictured as a temple. The chief cornerstone of God's building has been what? Rejected by the Jews. All right? Now, if you think in terms of the Old Testament, and as Jesus came, and all the prophecy over all of those centuries about the king that was going to come to Israel, all right, the establishment of the kingdom of God through Jesus Christ. Folks, God's been playing this since day one. All right? Now, here's what I want you to see. All that God has been doing since the time of Abraham to bless all the nations. He is bringing his son into this world. And God is building something new. All right? This is something new. The new thing that God is building is represented as a building. As a temple in these passages, and the building starts with what? Foundation. Jesus Christ is the foundation. The foundational element of all of the building that we're in is the cornerstone. All right? It's by that, the cornerstone that everything else in that is what? It's measured from the cornerstone. That's the starting place. That's the beginning. That's the foundation of the kingdom that we're in. That's his point. Verse 42, have you never read the scriptures? The stone which the builders rejected. That's the men that Jesus are speaking to. They're the builders. The stone which the builders had, they rejected, the chief cornerstone. Amazing. If all that God is building is going to be built on Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone, can you tell me what happens to those that reject him? You think that the people who reject Jesus are going to be the chosen people of God? Do you think any nation that rejects Jesus Christ is going to be a blessed nation of God? The leaders of the Jewish nation, you know what? To them, Jesus Christ was unsuited to be their leader. He was unsuited to be their king. He's not somebody we're going to follow. We reject this. This is our idea of the king. We don't want him. But there's more. Chapter 21, verse 42. Drop down to verse 44. Most unusual thing is said here, and it's the concept. It might be difficult for some of us to look at, but listen carefully. Jesus said in verse 44 again, whoever falls on this stone, who's the stone? Jesus is the stone. We've established that. He's the chief cornerstone. Whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whomever it falls, it will grind him to powder. These builders were now doing what? They weren't. They were what? Following or falling on the stone. They were falling over the stone. You know, they see this stone. What happens? They trip. They fall. You know, I'd be walking along in the dark, even in the daytime. I'm the biggest cluster is. I'll walk over. What happens when you walk over a big stone? You trip. You fall. What? You get hurt. You're going to break a leg. You're going to break an arm. That's what Jesus says. Whoever falls on this stone, what's going to happen to him? They're going to be broken. They're going to be broken. These men rejecting Jesus, now following, they're falling, they're stumbling on this stone. They are injuring themselves. But you know, that's bad. But you know what? It gets worse. Look at it. It goes on to say, whoever falls on this stone, going to be broken. But on whoever it falls, it will grind them to powder. The builders were falling over the stone. They rejected the idea of Jesus. Here's this large stone here. Someone comes walking along. They walk and slam into the stone. They reject Jesus. That's what they're doing. And so then Jesus said, what? The stone's going to fall on them? Huh. It's not that you're just walking along. Now the stone's above you. Now the stone's over top of you and the stone's being dropped. And what happens then, it crushes you. It crushes you like powder, it says. And that's what Jesus is saying to these men. It's bad enough to fall over a stone, but it gets much worse. You know what? If you continue this and you continue to reject me, the chief cornerstone, that's going to fall on you and crush you. On the judgment day, you're going to perish forever. You're done. You're like powder. It's over for you. You don't stand a chance, Israel, Jews, those that reject the stone, you builders. That's the picture Jesus wants us to see. I'll tell you what, it's serious business to reject Jesus Christ. You will be in trouble with God like you've never been in trouble before if you reject Jesus Christ. I remember the first day of school in my life, in the first grade, I got a paddling by the principal, and I still feel that in my stomach. I can still feel it. But I'll tell you what, there's not going to be any feeling like it to fall in the hands of the Almighty God on the judgment day that I've ignored and I've kept tripping over this stone, the chief cornerstone that's been given to me. There's still more. We've looked at 42 and 44. Let's look at 43. Verse 43. Notice what he says. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing the fruit of it. The kingdom of God will be taken away from you. The nation of Israel, the nation of the Jews, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you. You know, I don't stand up here and just make up stuff, whether you believe that or not. I didn't make that up. I just read that. That's what the book says. And that's what the book says about Jesus Christ. Now, you can see the impact of this bomb on the Jews and on the Jewish nation and on the Jewish leaders. What do you mean? We're God's people. We've always been God's people. What are you talking about? The kingdom of God? We're not going to be the kingdom of God any longer. We're not going to have that special relationship any longer. You've severed us now. No wonder they killed him. Well, that made, no wonder they killed him. That's why they wanted to kill him. You mean we're not under the rule of God? We're not the peculiar people the whole world knows anymore? In the past, they'd acknowledged God as their king. They served God as their king, but Jesus now says no more. The privilege of that relationship is now taken away from you forever. Forever. All right? Now, what he's talking about now, that it's going to be given to somebody that's going to bear fruit of it, well, what's that? Acts chapter 28. Notice what just burnt every Jew that was there. Actually, it started in Acts 10. We know that conversion when the gospel went to the Gentiles. Therefore, verse 28, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. Wow. Wow, the Jewish nation wouldn't hear it. Paul was selected by God, by his son Jesus Christ, to preach to the Gentiles. And now they're going to hear the gospel. Now they're going to be in the kingdom of God. Unheard of. All families, all nations, neither Jew, neither Greek, neither male, neither female, neither slave, neither free, all are free. All are the same under Jesus Christ. We're all in the same kingdom. Well, how could that be, folks? And I look at these words. I don't know. Could it be any plainer? Could it be any more blunt? More direct than what Jesus said in verse 40. That kingdom's done. You're done. It's been taken away from you. God's got a new people now. And you've rejected it. Well, Jesus Christ, a new nation. Jesus said he's going to give someone else. Who is that? Now, when you think about, and again, this may be a problem with a lot of people, and I know that it is, that their concept of a kingdom is not the concept that the New Testament teaches about the kingdom. The Jews were looking for a physical king to restore Israel. That's in Acts chapter 1. They even clear up to the day of Pentecost. They thought the Lord was going to take over and run the show. No, that's not why he came. It's a spiritual kingdom. There was a land promise. There was a physical Israel, still is. There was a physical king. They had kings. But you know what? They looked for the king. And this concept of a spiritual kingdom, no, that's not what they wanted. No, they didn't want that. But now it's a spiritual nation. We're in a spiritual kingdom. That's the difference. And that's what people fail to realize. And this idea that we're going to restore Israel, we're going to do this, the temple's going to be built there. Can somebody tell me why that's so? Do we want a temple in Jerusalem now? Do you know what the temple was used for? The blood of bulls and goats. Do you know what you're saying when you say that needs to be done? And why that relationship needs to be reestablished? You're saying that the blood of Christ is not enough. That's saying that the blood of Jesus Christ can't cleanse you from your sin. We need to get the temple back in order. Those things are done. They've been nailed to the cross. We're in a spiritual kingdom. The physical Israel is over. Nothing in here says have that relationship. Oh, we need to be careful. No, sir. Nothing in here about that. Nothing. Well, 1 Peter. I want you to notice 1 Peter chapter 2. We talked about how Jesus is going to build another nation. Not the nation of Israel, not at all. But there's another nation with another people. Now, remember all those verses that we looked at in the Gospels. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. Now, and coming to him as a, what? What are we? A living stone, which has been rejected by men. He's a living stone. The Lord's a living stone that they've tripped all over, got hurt. He smashed them, put them to powder. He's the stone. He was rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God. That's his son. You also, what are we? Living stones are being built up into a physical house. No. A spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices that are acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. No more physical sacrifices. We're in a spiritual household. We're a spiritual nation. We're spiritually minded. We offer up spiritual sacrifices in our life as we serve Jesus Christ. This and only this is what's acceptable to God. For this, he says, is contained in Scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed. This precious value then is for you who believe, but for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, who rejected it? Israel, the Jews, the builders. They became the very corner. He said this became the very cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. The Lord offended every Jew he met. And Israel hated him. And they killed him. For they stumble. Why? Because they are disobedient to the word and to this doom. He says they were also appointed. God knew that that was going to happen. Who's he talking about? Nation of Israel? No, sir. He's talking about those who believe in Jesus Christ. If you're in the church, you're in the kingdom. If you're in the kingdom, you're in the church. If you're in the church, you're in the body. If you're in the body, you're in the kingdom. You're in the church. That's what he's talking about. This is a spiritual kingdom. This is a spiritual household. We're living stones built up into a spiritual household to make spiritual sacrifices. That's the kingdom. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Here we are. A people for God's own possession. Here we are. So that you may proclaim this excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Here we are. For you once were not a people. We certainly were not. Now we're a nation. But now you are the people of God. You have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Was a time, was there not? Certainly was. You're that holy nation. See those connections in Matthew 21, what we just read? I certainly do. I see it fulfilled. We don't stumble at Jesus. I'm not stumbling over that rock. I'm not stumbling over that cornerstone. I'm going to fully accept, obey, and be obedient to the cornerstone. Because in doing that, I become part of the holy nation. I become part of the spiritual kingdom that's been prophesied about all through Scripture. I'm not looking for a physical Israel. It's over. I'm not looking for a physical temple. It's over. It's over. There's only one kingdom, and folks, we're in it right now. And it began on the day of Pentecost when 3,000 people obeyed the gospel of Christ and were added to the church, to the kingdom. That was it. Anyone who follows Jesus can be a part of the kingdom of God. Anyone. The Jewish nation, the Jewish people, you know what, folks? They're just like me and you. They need Jesus Christ exactly the same way that you and I need Jesus Christ. They any different from us? No, sir. If you're outside the gospel, they're lost just like you are. They're alienated from Christ. They're alienated from all the blessings just like you are. That's plain in the scriptures. Jesus Christ is the only Savior. And really, we need to stop thinking about Israel being God's people. Folks, you're God's people. We're the ones. We started off talking about this guy in San Antonio named John Hagee. Hagee's wrong. He's wrong. It's false teaching. And 99% of the denominational world and your friends and neighbors are wrong for believing anything about physical Israel, fulfillment of prophecy, thousand-year reign, go on and on and on. That's another 10,000 lessons. I tried to get it all in a half hour, but I won't. Hagee's wrong, but how about you? And I'm not talking about what you think about the Jewish nation. I'm talking about you as far as the relationship that you have with God. Are you all right tonight? That's the question, really, that's most vital right now. Are you all right? Is your relationship with God right? Have you been tripping over the chief cornerstone? Have you been allowing the injuries to come that Satan will throw at you because you're not in him? You're not where all spiritual blessings are. Jesus said, in him is all spiritual blessings. Paul said that in Ephesians 1:3. And included in that is forgiveness of your sins. You need to be immersed in water before you can have the relationship with God or Jesus that is required in order you to call God your Father and have the forgiveness of those sins. Please come as together we stand and sing.